Once a year, users and developers meet at the German Amiga Fair. This regular event usually takes place in Cologne. Hello and welcome live at Cologne Media Park to the Amiga 2001. In many ways, this show marks both a conclusion and a new beginning. For the first time, Amigans can make use of modern PCI cards thanks to the availability of various PCI expansion boards. For the first time, the prototype of the new Pegasus by B-Plan is shown publicly. And hopefully, for the last time, it's a show where no new computers can be bought. And now let's have a look at what can be bought here. In the early hours, many visitors already began pouring into the fairground. For most of them, the tour began at the booths of the Amiga dealers. Visalia and KDH Datentechnik had brought along everything an Amiga could dream of. And Coolbits also showed their available supply. Public interest was higher than expected. At the booth of Falke Media, for instance, the team of Dreisat brought themselves up to date. Apart from some other things, one could also buy the latest issue of the Amiga Plus there. And the Amiga Future team showed the latest issue too. A few Amigans could already have a look at a new Italian Amiga magazine, the Bitplane. The link to the outside world was provided by the Amiga Club. Thanks to IRC conferences and a webcam, those who weren't able to attend could still get a lot of information about what was going on. As always, Rolf Tinkler furnished each and every kind of hardware with logos and pictures. Those who want to lower their printing costs could save a lot of money by using the refill kits from Refill24. Additionally, an innovative CD archiving system was presented at their booth. A lot of bustle, crowded corridors, just like in the old times. One reason for all this activity is the multitude of new hardware presented at the fair. Only 2 years ago it was still unthinkable, but nowadays one can use common PCI cards in the Amiga, thanks to PCI expansion boards. After last year's presentation of the G-Rex 1200, DCE demonstrated a special version for the Amiga 4000 this time. Elbox presented the whole Mediator family. The version for the A1200, which was already shown at the last fair, was accompanied by one for Zorro 4 expansion boards. Inside a showcase, something entirely new could be seen, the Mediator for the Amiga 4000. Like with the G-Rex, it's possible to use the most common graphics cards, sound cards, network adapters and TV cards. A wide range of drivers is already available. Underneath there was the final Shark PPC, a G3 G4 expansion card. Production will start as soon as Amiga OS 4 is finished. Along with the current products, individual computers showed a pre-production version of the interface board Vario. A pleasant surprise was the presentation of the Subway USB controller, which supports USB 1.1 and 2.0. The highlight of the fair was B-Plan's Pegasus board, the first new Amiga motherboard since 1993. Of course, we wanted to know more about that. Mr. Carter from B-Plan is now standing with me. Mr. Carter, where did the idea to develop this new computer originate?
The basic idea was to give the Amiga market a new innovative hardware, to make the performance of the PowerPC available to the user.
How fast is the new computer, for example, compared to the power-up cards?
We have a major performance increase due to the new processors, the G3, G4 and G4 Plus, so that the new system will be 10 to 20 times as fast.
And how compatible is the new system in regards of old software? For instance, will AGA software work and will it be able to boot from old Amiga disks?
Man kann natürlich über entsprechende Emulatoren an diesem.
Of course, one can only run AGA software by using emulation, which means it will be quite slow. The basic concept is to use programs which run on original Amigas equipped with graphics cards.
Programme zu verwenden, die auf normalen Amigas auf Grafikkarten ohne Probleme laufen.
Mhm. What about support? Will there be a hotline?
Der Vertrieb findet eigentlich aus.
Distribution is solely handled by authorized dealers. We will give our know-how to them and they will take care of the support.
Weitergegeben und der Support wird über den Fachhandel abgewickelt.
And finally a question about the operating system. Who holds the actual rights to Morphos?
Das ist eine gute Frage. Was immer falsch verstanden.
That's a good question. In the internet, there was the impression that Morphos is a mixture from AmigaOS and other things. That's of course not the case. The hardware is driven by a kernel. This is Morphos. On top of this kernel, there's a 68K emulation, which is then able to execute Amiga programs. We also regard the Amiga operating systems 3.1, 3.5, and 3.9 as Amiga programs, and that means the user uses the license he already has and simply runs the software on the new hardware using Morphos.
Benutzt seine Lizenz, die er bereits hat vom Amiga Betriebssystem und führt sie nur mit Hilfe von Morphos auf der neuen Hardware aus.
Consequently, it will be as easy as installing an old Amiga hard disk into the Pegasus and copying the Morphos kernel to be able to boot an old environment on the new hardware. Apart from the usual PCI and AGP slots and the standard ports, the Pegasus board features all modern ports such as FireWire, USB, network, digital audio and infrared. Using a riser card, the PCI slots can be aligned as preferred. By changing the CPU module, the user can choose his favorite power PC. Up to 2 G3, G4 or G5 CPUs with theoretically any clock rate can be used in the Pegasus. With the 400 MHz G3, the 68K emulation is already as fast as an 060 with 50 MHz. The JIT version, which will be integrated in the final product, is even 12 times faster. The best result is achieved with native code, with which the software runs 50 times as fast as an 060. In terms of software, everything which is well known on today's Amigas is supported. Apart from 68K software, PowerUp, WarpOS and Warp3D programs can be run, and a native Linux version would also be available. And that's how the Pegasus will look like in the version distributed by Visalia. Now that we've seen the latest hardware, let's have a look at the software. There are quite a few applications here, even some for Morphos. Titan Computer are currently working on the Morphos version of Papyrus Office. This Office package combines the slimness of the Amiga with MS Office compatibility and DTP functions into a complete solution for professional and home users. Papyrus is also available for Windows, macOS and Atari TOS. Motion Studio, a complete video editing software similar to iMovie on the Macintosh, is also under development. That way it will be possible to edit DV videos and to combine film sequences using a diversity of transitions. As title generator, Candy Factory 2 is used. This versatile text generator can, of course, also be used without Motion Studio. Additionally, Burnit Pro will be released exclusively in a Morphos version. Hager & Partner didn't show new applications this time. However, one could purchase all the current ones, such as Amiga Writer and Artifact, directly at the booth. Recently, Hager & Partner have started offering the creation of small CD series as a service, which includes burning them using a copying station and printing the labels on the recordables. After a long break in development, the Root Planner AMI Atlas was finally presented in the new version 6. This version contains many additional maps and, for the first time, an extensive hotel and city guide. At the booth of Schatztruhe and Cluanto, the Amiga emulator package Amiga Forever was shown in version 5, which also contains some video sequences, and the presentation software MediaPoint MP2000 was offered. However, not only new applications are in preparation. The Amiga OS is also being developed further. Management of the project was taken over by Hyperion, a company which is also familiar with other operating systems and so can bring the best from other worlds into the Amiga OS. Ben Hermans from Hyperion is now standing aside to me. Mr. Hermans, why did Hyperion become the project leader for OS 4?
We decided to do OS4 because we are one of the few remaining companies in the Amiga market that still has a professional development team with full-time professional coders who are working on it full-time. And we've seen with the games development that we've been doing that there's some major bottlenecks in the Amiga operating system, and this is the reason why we want to do it ourselves, so make sure that it actually happens. There are so many other projects out there currently, but we think we can give the Amiga users the best possible product for the PPC.
What's the roadmap for new features and releases?
We are aiming for an initial release in February of 2002. This will be OS4 basically. It will have the most important features that you will find possibly on the Amiga website and also on the presentation that I did yesterday and today here in the show in Cologne. It might well be that the initial version might not have all these features, but we have a very straightforward plan to add them later on. Afterwards, you will see OS 4.2 and so forth, but we are currently focusing only on OS 4.0 because that's already quite a lot of work as it is to get it out in February of 2002.
This project surely takes a significant amount of resources. Are you going to release any new games in the next months?
Well, it's clear that we will indeed have to allocate a lot of resources to get this out in 2002 February. So as a result, games development is going to suffer a little bit. This is inevitable. We only have a limited amount of people and a lot of work. So as a result, for instance, RealSoft has been delayed. Our port of RealSoft has been delayed somewhat. We had some other Amiga projects which are currently on hold, things like Worms Armageddon. We simply didn't get around doing it. We started out being a games company interested in doing just games, but as time progressed it became very much apparent that Amiga was relying on us to do a lot more than just doing games. We would then have to do 3D technology, WOP3D drivers and so forth. We are now doing also Radeon Voodoo 3 drivers and Permedia 2 and 3, and as a result we more and more got sucked into actually doing the technology rather than just the content for the technology. But it's a chicken and egg situation. If there is no technology, we cannot make the content, and without that we don't have a business. So we first need to have the technology, and nobody else was really going to do it or could do it in this time frame, so we needed to do it ourselves. Mind you, however, we are not just doing this alone. We have a majority of OS 3.5 and 3.9 developers behind us. We are working with Hagen and partner with other companies, the P96 team, Olaf Bartel, a whole wide range of people. About 18 to 20 people are working on OS4, and a lot of work was already done. It's now a question of integrating it to a satisfactory solution.
And now we want to take a look at the more entertaining side of the Amiga, the games. A lot of them were presented here, and even more are just now in production. At the last fair it was shown only as a beta version. This year we can buy it. Shogo. The Lithtech engine from this 3D action shooter will get the maximum out of your power-up cards. In Free Space, the Great War, you've got the possibility to engage in fights and navigate your vessel through the galaxy, using nearly every input device available. Mouse, keyboard, CD32 gamepad, PlayStation controller or the good old joystick. The player decides how to steer his craft in the vacuum. After a long period of time, there's finally a new original highlight for the Amiga. The gangster simulation Payback from Apex Design. Using WOP3D and a PowerPC, the game's shootouts and rapid car rides are very impressive. Where else can you burst roadblocks with a fully occupied bus? You were also able to get some first impressions of Project CrashSite. As a member of the Future Security Corps, you are to uphold justice far from our solar system. The game itself features many kinds of gameplay. At the booth of Visalia, Funtime World and Amiga Arena presented the tossing game Puzzle Bobs. Even with its simple rules, it is sure to pin the player down for hours. In Crossfire 2, which was presented by APC and TCP, the trigger-happy players can fly through giant levels using a vast amount of different weapons in three different game modes. The mission pack for Earth 2140 was not yet available because of some logistic problems. But there were some other games presented at the Epic Interactive booth, which will be released on the Amiga. People files will be available soon for both Amiga OS and Morphos. In this classic 2D adventure, the main character is the alien Feebu, who has the mission to make circles in crop fields. In Birdie Shoot, you will soon be able to hunt different sorts of birds on the Amiga using Morphos, just like in the well-known game Morhoon. The strategists among us will soon be able to test their skills with the Morphos version of Knights and Merchants. In contrast to other civilization building games on the Amiga, this one mainly focuses on battles. And if, for some reason, that should not be enough for you, you can look forward to the conversions of Earth 2150, Escape from the Blue Planet, or Sime the Sorcerer 3D for Morphos. Titan Computer also had some games in their supply. Amigans with a PPC card or users of Morphos would soon be able to prove the tactics with alien nations. Just like in The Settlers, one plans economic circulations and competes against other peoples. A conversion of the strategy game Majesty is also planned. The tactical multiplayer shooter Rage Hard, which is currently in development, will be released in a version for Morphos and possibly also for Amiga OS 4. Similar as in Counter-Strike for the PC, up to 32 players can fight with or against each other. The game is based on the engine of Claws of the Devil, which itself is on hold at the present. After showing you the latest about Amiga OS 4 and Morphos, we'd like to know what the visitors think about the new operating systems. Markus is asking around upstairs.
Thanks, Dennis. Of course, I'm mainly interested in which operating system the users would buy if Amiga OS 4 and Morphos were already available.
Entschuldigung, kurze Frage. Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
Amiga OS 4.
Kurze Frage. Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
Morphos.
Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
OS 4.
Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
Also OS 4 hat man noch nicht mehr so viel gehört, ne? In letzter Zeit. Also eher Morphos.
Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
Amiga OS 4.
Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
Morphos mittlerweile, muss ich sagen. Also bei Amiga OS, man sieht ja nichts davon. Amiga ist nicht hier. Und Morphos haben wir eine Plattform, vor allem die neue Hardware. Der Amiga One, ja, Prototypen haben wir auch noch nicht davon gesehen. Schauen wir mal.
Ich darf das Interview mal kurz unterbrechen. Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
Da würde ich Amiga OS 4 vorziehen, weil ich mit Amiga OS 3.9 gute Erfahrungen gemacht habe und gerne in dieser Linie weitermachen würde.
Und wie sieht's hier aus? Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
Weder noch. Abwarten.
Abwarten.
Classic bleiben, PCI aufrüsten und dann schauen wir mal.
Ganz kurze Frage. Amiga OS 4 oder Morphos?
Amigas OS 4.
Genau, alles klar, vielen Dank.
Once again, the Amiga community seems to be split. Amiga OS and Morphos are about head-to-head, so let's wait and see which solution will be winning. We'll hopefully know more at the next fair.
Well, Amiga OS 4 or Morphos? That is the question. But there's another answer to this question. Here we're back at the booth of Hager & Partner, where the Amiga OS XL is presented along with the latest applications. Similar to the Eternity One from the last fair, the new software emulates an Amiga on a contemporary PC. Not using UAE, but two more hardware-bound emulators. Let's have a closer look at this. To be precise, Amiga OS XL is a package containing the two emulators Amiga XL and Amithlon. Amithlon is set upon a small Linux kernel, which then boots directly into the Amiga OS. All of the available hardware is being implemented into the operating system by special drivers. Unfortunately, this means that the programs which need the AGA or ECS chipset aren't executable anymore. The good news are that the system is getting really fast, because it isn't restricted by inherited burdens anymore. Rendering 3D graphics is so fast on modern hardware that your image will be done long before your coffee will. And Warp 3D is now also supported. Amiga XL works a bit differently. First, the real-time operating system QNX is launched, which once should have been the base for the new Amiga OS. QNX is fully functional in this version, and all present applications, like the internet browser Voyager, can be launched easily. One of these applications is the Amiga emulator Amiga XL, based on UAE. After booting the Amiga system, all 68K programs can be run at an unbelievable speed. But because of higher compatibility to older software, it's less fast than Amithlon. The host system QNX is also used to access the PC hardware, so there's no need for developing special Amiga drivers. By combining these two emulators in one package, the user is able to choose the ideal program depending on the software he wants to run, either especially fast or especially compatible. If you like exclusive things, then you can order the Silverblue 1800 Plus in a designer tower at Hager & Partner. You get this fast x86 PC with pre-installed Amiga OS XL for 2555 euro.
The feud between Amiga and Atari has been settled for long, and so the old rivals attend the same fair for the second time. Now let's have a look at the new stuff in the Atari Park. In the entrance area, Cortex Design presented the Eclipse PCI adapter for the Atari Falcon. Now it is possible to use the popular ATI 3D RAID 2 graphics board on your Falcon. Right next door, EH Systems showed Ethernet adapters for almost all Atari computers, as well as a mouse adapter for getting ordinary PC mice connected. Fun Media, the video editing system for Milan, was presented around the corner. Extensive effects and the implementation of 3D objects make this program very interesting for hobby filmers. ROM Logicware showed the latest version of the word processing program Papyrus Office on a TI book with Virtual PC. Falcon Media offered various copies of the ST computer and some CDs with tools at their booth. Also, a UMAX Mac clone, which was for sale too, was presented here running the Atari emulator Magic Mac. And look at those sweet Mac lovelies, which were also for sale. Expansions like Milan Blaster 16 were offered too, and you could see the Gem Hapag TV board in action. Because of a missing cable connection, the good old Jaguar was used as video player. Of course, the first Atari Club Colonia and the Pro Atari Computer Club were on site, and the online magazine Atos was there too. 1632-bit systems still had some rare treasures in their shelves. And even an Archon computer had found the way to the fair.
Two strenuous days end. The hall is getting empty and the infamous chaos of the fair is decreasing.
And though the sparkle of the old times was missing at the Amiga 2001, you can clearly see that there's some kind of awakening mood in the air. The show will go on, but the direction is unknown.
Which operating system will win the race? What will the future of the Amiga look like? Why is the banana crooked? These and other questions will be cleared when we're back again, live!
And though the sparkle of the old times was missing at the Amiga 2001, you can clearly see that there's... Wieso kriege ich die Sätze mit den vielen TH's drin?